is number three. Two cases, the right images. We can see high position of the patella with long patellar tendon on the left. We can see low position of the patella with short patellar tendon. Another finding, we can see heterotopic ossification along the second quadriceps tendon, which indicates chronic injury. Diagnosis, this case is patella alta, this case is patella baja. MRI, long patellar tendon, high position of the patella, patella alta, short patellar tendon, and low position of patella, patella baja. Okay. What are the causes of patella alta? It's a frequent cause of patellar maltracking. And in this diagram, we will see other causes of patellar maltracking. In the quadriceps tendon, in the patella, in the trochlea, and tibial tuberosity, all these lesions can cause patellar maltracking. Quadriceps, abnormal Q angle, which is an angle between two lines, or described later, patella, patella. Cause in the patella, patella alta, lateral patellar tilt, lateral patellar displacement, trochlea, trochlear dysplasia, and lateral tibial tuberosity lateralization. All this can cause patellar maltracking. What is the meaning of patellar maltracking? The patella is subluxated laterally on flexion. Okay. We see everyone individually. Abnormal Q angle. How to measure the Q angle by between two lines. The first line is between the anterior superior iliac spine and the patellar center. And the second line is between the tibial tuberosity and the patellar center. The angle should be less than 25 degrees. If more than 25 degrees, this predisposes a lateral patellar subluxation on flexion. When you flex the knee, the patella is popped out. Okay. The second group of causes, patellar causes, patella alta, we have described. Okay, lateral patellar tilt, the patella is tilted. We can measure the angle between two lines. The first line is tangential to the femoral posterior surface of femoral condyle. This line is parallel to this line. The second line is passing along the lateral and the medial patellar margin. This angle should be less than 5 degrees. More than 5 degrees, this indicates the lateral patellar tilt. Last patellar cause of patellar maltracking is lateral patellar displacement or subluxation. How you can measure? By measuring the distance between patellar median patellar ridge and the trochlear apex. This is a lateral patellar facet, medial patellar facet, and this is patellar ridge. This is lateral trochlear facet, medial trochlear facet, and trochlear apex. The distance between the patellar median patellar ridge and trochlear apex should be less than 6 millimeters. If more than 6 millimeters, this means lateral patellar displacement. Okay. Trochlear causes of patellar maltracking: shallow trochlea. How you measure the shallow trochlea? By measuring the trochlear tips, two vertical lines along from the trochlear apex. And the lateral trochlear facet and the medial trochlear facet. The distance between these two lines should be less than, more than 3 millimeters. If less than 3 millimeters, this means shallow trochlea. Second type is lateral trochlear inclination angle. Okay, this is a normal lateral trochlear inclination angle. If it is it can be more shallow with decreased lateral trochlear inclination angle. If it is decreased less than 11 degrees, this means the trochlear dysplasia. Another sign of trochlear dysplasia is trochlear facet asymmetry. One of the trochlear facets is much smaller than the other, less than 40% than the other facet. This also predisposes to lateral patellar subluxation. The last cause of patellar maltracking, lateralization of the tibial tuberosity. How to measure? By measuring a distance called TT, TG distance. What is the meaning? TT means tibial tuberosity, TG means trochlear groove. You measure the distance between the trochlear groove and tibial tuberosity. If it is more than 20 millimeters, this will cause lateral patellar tendon subluxation and patellar tendon and patellar subluxation. Okay. Then these are all causes of patellar maltrack. Now we will discuss the effects of patellar maltrack. First, in acute trauma, it can predispose to acute lateral patellar dislocation. How we will describe? First, there is a tear in the medial patellar tenacula. When the patella is subluxated, the medial facet is impacted against the lateral surface of the lateral femoral condyle. Okay. Then, when the patient is imaged, the patella is relocated again in its normal disposition. That is why it is called transient lateral patellar dislocation. Okay. The second is the Hoffa's fat of bed impingement syndrome. Lateral displacement of the patellar tendon can cause impingement against the lateral femoral trochlea, which causes impingement on the Hoffa's bed of fat and the edema. Another complication of patellar maltreating, chondromalacia patelli. Okay, we will discuss the grades of chondromalacia patelli later. The last thing is patellofemoral osteoarthritis, narrow joint space, subchondral sclerosis, and marginal osteoporosis. We can see that the patellar subluxation also. We have seen this, we will discuss all cases of knee impingement syndrome or friction syndrome. The first one we have described it before, lateral patellar tendon subluxation with impingement against femoral condyle, lateral femoral condyle, on soft tissue edema along the Hoffa's bed of fat. It's called Hoffa's fat of bed impingement syndrome. Okay, lateral patellar tendon subluxation with edema of the Hoffa's bed of fat. Hoffa's fat of bed impingement syndrome. This is a normal subject for comparison. Normal signal of the Hoffa's bed of fat with no lateral patellar tendon subluxation. The second type of friction syndrome is iliotibial band syndrome. Friction occurs against the lateral femoral condyle with edema of the fat between the iliotibial band and femoral condyle. We can see edema here in axial images also. The third, this is a iliotibial band syndrome compared to the normal subject. Don't mistake these structures for edema. It is just blood vessels that appear bright on the stereo images. The third type is suprapatellar impingement syndrome. You can see here the suprapatellar fat edematous with convex posterior marsh. It's a number subject for comparison. And this is the edematous, suprapatellar bed of fat, normal suprapatellar bed of fat. The fourth type of knee impingement syndromes, postural medial impingement syndrome, which you can see edema surrounding the gracilis tendon. This is the least common type of impingement syndrome and very rare. This all type of knee flexion syndrome, Hoffa's bed of fat impingement syndrome, suprapatellar fat bed impingement syndrome, iliotibial band flexion syndrome, and postural medial impingement syndrome.